Warm welcome, everyone. My name is Associate Professor Anna Sullivan. I'm the Director of the Centre for Research in Educational and Social Inclusion at the University of South Australia. I would like to open this webinar by acknowledging the land that we meet on today here in Adelaide, anyways, the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and pay my respects to elders past and present. We pay our respects to their connection to land, sea, and community. These connections are still as important to the living Kaurna people today. I would also like to acknowledge the First Peoples, the traditional owners and custodians of the land where each of you may be joining into this seminar. The Centre for Research in Educational and Social Inclusion is a research centre that focuses on contributing new knowledge about issues related to educational and social inclusion. On behalf of our centre, we are delighted to be working in partnership with a research initiative transforming early education and child health, or TEACH, at Western Sydney University, and to host this symposium on culturally inclusive early childhood pedagogies. We have five research presentations today with a 3 to 5 minute break in between each. We will then conclude the symposium with a discussion generated by a panel representing research, teaching, and leadership. And before we begin, a couple of housekeeping matters. This seminar is being recorded and it will be uploaded for public view, and you'll be emailed about that in coming days. Please turn off your camera if you do wish not to be recorded. And I've asked that everyone keeps their mics on mute during the session unless they've been asked to speak. I'd now like to introduce you to the co-founders of this international network of researchers who will also be co-chairs of this symposium. The CRESI executive member, Dr. Jamie Sisson, who's done a lot of work to bring this together in collaboration with the TEACH Deputy Director, Associate Professor Chris Wardrow. So a warm welcome to both of you.
Thanks for that, Anna, and welcome everyone. This symposium feels like it's been a long time coming, hasn't it? The symposium highlights the contemporary research, theory, and practice that informs our thinking about early childhood pedagogies in a way that moves us beyond cultural competence. Presenters include members of the International Collaboration for Cultural Inclusive Early Childhood Pedagogies, that's CIECP. And CIECP is an international network of researchers who've been coming together over about the past 2 years. The purpose of this symposium is to stimulate critical reflection and dialogue to explore possibilities for informing future policy and practice. During the symposium, we reflect on the following questions. How do theoretical perspectives inform understandings about pedagogy, practice, learning, and children's play? How can we promote cultural integrity in early childhood pedagogy? And what pedagogies and practices honor an image of all children as capable citizens who are valued for their contributions to their communities? I now have the privilege to introducing you to the first presenters, Sue Grisharber and Sally Barnes, who will be presenting their recent literature review on playing with the politics of play.
Thanks so much, Jamie. Hello, everyone. Sally and I are presenting today from a chapter that has just been published in a book edited by Tim Kinnard and Gail Canella, and you can see the reference there on the screen. Sally was the research assistant on this project and did the literature search. So she's also a co-author, and it's great to be involved with her on this work. Next slide, please. So this is a scoping literature review that we're going to talk about. The aims were to find out exactly what sort of literature was there in refereed journals and how dominant understandings of play are challenged. We're interested to inform policymakers about this work because I'm not sure just how much they're aware of this type of work that's been undertaken. And we were looking specifically at play that had been othered or is other. And for that, we were meaning play that's been conceptualized from outside the child development paradigm. Thanks, Jamie. So there are just some details about what a scoping literature review does. It gives a snapshot of what's been undertaken in a particular area. We had a particular time frame, which was January 2009 to December 2019. We looked at only refereed journal articles, mainly because we were interested in knowing what was published in refereed journal articles, because there are a couple of awesome edited books that are available that have chapters in them that deal with the topic that we were investigating. But we were wanting to know what is there in terms of metrics and the sorts of refereed journal articles that are valued by universities these days in Australia, but also internationally. Thanks, Jamie. I think we're over to Sally now.
Okay, thank you. So I'm just going to talk to the next little group of slides, and there's lots of information on all of these slides. I'm not going to read them to you, but I'll just try to highlight a couple of the main points on each of them. So this slide here outlines the step-by-step process that we followed. And as you might have seen from the previous couple of slides, the review was informed by the work of Arxie and O'Malley and Booth et al, but it was also informed, and particularly the process that we followed, by Frey et al's scoping review of empirical research on the aspirations of Australian school students for higher education. They set out a really clear process that we were able to use to inform what we were doing. So as you can see, the process involved several database searches as well as several subsequent manual searches for additional references. And just some points about this slide. The databases that we chose were really selected on the basis that they were most likely to provide us with the greatest number of references for what we were investigating across the broadest range of journals. And I think it's interesting that when I did the initial keyword search, which was play and early childhood, I originally came up with 4,027 articles in that time period, which included duplicates. But once I did the second search and added in play and early childhood and feminist, or play and early childhood and critical theory, we reduced it down to 83 articles. So there was a significant difference in the number of articles. And then once we had done further reviews of the articles and additional manual searches, we actually only ended up with 48 full text articles for the scoping review. And you can see there the journals where the majority of articles came from: children's geographies, contemporary issues in early childhood, and early childhood development and care. Okay, the next one, Jamie, please. So this just outlines how we managed the final 48 articles. We developed a review template, and that was used for each of the articles. And you can see the kind of information that we collected. We did read all of the articles, at least one of us read all of the articles, and some of those articles had to be read more than once to decide whether or not they belonged in the final 48. And we added the themes as we were added to the template as they were identified. One of the things I would say is that one of the challenges in finding the articles is that play is a really interesting thing in early childhood, in that it's quite amorphous. It's in everything, and it's often hard to pull it apart from the other aspects of early childhood that somebody might be looking at. So somebody might be looking at place, but it's also about children playing, but the word play is not necessarily emphasized in the article, even though what's happening is about play. So some of the articles really required us to do that second reading in order to really work out whether or not they belonged in this review. The final five themes are listed there, but I'll discuss those in a minute. The next slide. Okay, so we've got in the findings, we've got characteristics, methodology and methods, and data generation and themes. So this is really about the item characteristics. The year, just some facts on here, the year that had the highest numbers of articles that was published was 2017. We had the countries represented by the authors, the country of origin for the first author, and the journals. The theories that were used by the authors as a conceptual framework for analysis and discussion were identified. And interestingly, posthumanism or aspects of posthuman theory. And the aspects of posthuman theory that came up a lot were diffraction, assemblages, and interaction. That they above all came up over and over and over again. In some, they referenced the theory, whilst like, so they would say posthumanism, but others referenced specific theorists. So Barad was common. And Foucault. So in some instances, we had the name of theorists, but not always. Going back to posthuman theory being probably the most popular, they were followed by the post-structuralist theories or a combination of post-structuralism and posthumanism, and then critical theories were the group where that people had used. Okay, the next slide. All right, so this is the slide noting the methodology and methods and forms of data generation that were used. There was there were a range of methods used by researchers, with ethnography being the most common. Interestingly, and perhaps a little frustratingly, 9 articles didn't really identify discernible methodology. So what they'd actually done and what how they'd done it was not always that clear. It was difficult to distinguish between methods and methodology in some instance. In terms of data generation, interviews were the most popular form of data collection, with observations, photographs, field notes, and videos also widely used. And in most instances, more than one source of data generation were used. And then the participants range in age from 15 months to 15 years, as you can see. Teaching assistants, pre-service teachers and educators, and a variety of early childhood settings, including those that were in nature and outdoor settings. Next slide, sorry. Okay, so there were 5 themes that we identified from the analysis of the articles. The first one being about defining and conceptualizing play. So these were the group of articles that either directly or indirectly challenged traditional understandings of play and offered new ways of thinking about play. And they don't, you can't put them together as a group of articles that all address the same kind of areas of play or characteristics of play. So they tackle different things, and that's the same for all of these themes. The second theme was about play environments. So these were the articles that challenged traditional ideas about what counts as an environment for play. Digital and multimodal nature of play environments is one example in that area. Outdoor and nature play, children's engagement and involvement in the outdoors, particularly with a lot of the post-human pieces. But also the resourcing of indoor play environments. So the positioning of furniture, for example, about how that changes the nature of what children do. The fourth theme was about the playing child. So they were the articles that raised questions about how the playing child can be understood. And again, this is where the post-human probably differed from when I think back 10 years ago to maybe when post-structural thinking was dominant in early childhood, and there were a lot of papers that were about gender or race, ethnicity.
5 minutes.
Thank you. The playing child was very much about interactions, entanglements, matter and discourse, how they work together to produce subjectivities. The work of teachers in play, of course, is about what do teachers do and what is the role of the educator. And the final group of articles were the policy mandates, and they were the articles that considered the implications for policy when play is conceptualized in non-traditional ways. Right, back to Sue.
So I just want to make a few comments about the policy mandates. And even though this was the smallest number of articles with 4 of the 48, there are some things I think that we really need to be thinking about as a field. So one of the things that came through was that economic imperatives can contradict equity aspects of policies. And there was often lip service paid to structural aspects such as gender, race, ethnicity, and culture. And there was a lack of resources to support or enact the policy requirements. And most of these four studies were small scale. And we know historically policymakers tend to take little notice of small scale studies. They pay a lot of attention to large scale studies. Something else that we found of interest, and that related to observations, which were mostly from developmental perspectives, and they don't consider race and oppression. So there were very little opportunities for educators to think about how you might take observations from a racial or an oppressive perspective as opposed to a child developmental perspective. So teachers also tended to be unaware of children's knowledge of race and how it was used in play and in social interactions. There was also an article that made the point that mandating the provision of racially and culturally diverse resources was important, but it needed to be supported by other policy mandates. I think we might go to the next slide, please. So here are some summative comments about the articles in general. There was an absence of Indigenous and First Nations authors. So there's a lot of scope for change there. Policies requiring racially and culturally diverse play materials were virtually silent on how race, ethnicity, culture, and other dimensions of difference should inform teacher-child interactions or the development of curriculum. There are a few examples that used colonialism or post-colonial theories. They were scarce, but they did look at colonial histories and current legacies from a post-human perspective. And there's an example there that Afrika Taylor led. There were a few items about inclusion or disability. 11 of the items were about gender. And you can see the representation of how we categorized the theoretical perspectives there. 23 of the articles were about post-humanism primarily, 20 were about post-structuralism, and 10 drew on critical theories. However, matters of race, ethnicity, ability, class, SES circumstances, and colonization were less common. And because of that, there was little opportunity for intersectional analysis. Next, please. So these are some of the things that we were pondering on the basis of the work that we'd done here. The talk didn't, in the articles, didn't necessarily mention play per se, and Sally mentioned that earlier, so I won't say anything else about that. Concepts like ethical practices as pedagogies appear to be rethinking aspects of play with theories that are inspired by political and ethical dimensions. So while they might not mention play, what was being talked about was play in a developmental sense, but was called different things from a post-humanist or new materialist perspective. So we think there's lots of potential for rethinking here. We think there's opportunities for powerful pedagogical impact that have implications for engagement and learning for all children. And we think there's possibilities for pedagogies that are based on political and ethical matters that of course relate to race, gender, ability, culture, SES, equity, human privilege, and environmental justice. So to have or realise those possibilities, the agenda needs to change from framing play through early childhood education discourses of child development to framing them through other theoretical perspectives. Thank you.
We can't hear you, Chris.
Wouldn't you think we've had enough practice with that? Thank you very much, both Sue and Sally, for such a provocating presentation. It's now my pleasure to introduce the presentation methods for engaging with funds of knowledge being offered by Jamie Sisson, Jackie Duarte, and myself. Jamie.
Chris, are these your slides?
Oh.
thought I was doing them. So sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry. Goodness me. This is for those of you that don't especially know a lot about funds of knowledge, although I think that most of our audience does today, that for many of us, our first encounter with the concept was through some of the classic work by Norma Gonzalez, Lewis Mole, Kathy Amanti, and I've forgotten the last name, they did some massive fabulous research around the cultural bodies of knowledge that are essential for well-being of families in Latino families. The approach now adopted in education settings provides these methodological tools through which we can engage with some of the complexity surrounding the diversity of children and children's life worlds as they enter into our super diverse learning environments. It's very strongly oriented towards understanding and engaging the less advantaged learners who might be like, because of where they live or because of the social structures that have created this disadvantage. It does aim to resonate with ways of knowing that is meaningful to children's lives as distinct from that is disconnected and has no resonance. It does need, in applying the funds of knowledge, it does need us to apply an image of the learner as being capable of the knower, of having knowable understandings and experiences that impart that deeper knowing about their own lives and the lives they lead with others. In the work that I've done, so this is my last little addition, it highlights the important role of the educator and a shift in the role of the educator from either being the facilitator, which many of us were trained in to facilitate, to being the expert, to this orientation of actually being a researcher of children's families, the person that sources what's happening in the life worlds of these children, their families, and the many multiple communities to which they belong. Am I doing this one too? Okay, so there's a quote there from Lewis Mole and his colleagues that you can read yourself, but it's very explanatory about where this approach kind of sits in an array of approaches that you might draw on, focusing on knowledge that students bring and using it as the foundation for learning. In our work, we talk about the building bridges between that authorized school world or curriculum world and the world where children actually live out their lives. Previously, in many of the contexts in which, many of us work, the emphasis tends to shift to what the children don't know, what they don't have, the forms of language that is not authorised, and the knowledge that school doesn't see as being relevant to its experiences. This emphasis on disadvantage does result in lowered expectations. It's been clearly shown. And impacts enormously on children's self-identity. It disrupts established knowledge hierarchies that almost always work in favour of the advantage. And here's some quotes from children and teachers. So a teacher, I know the children speak other languages, but it's not academic language, nothing I can use in my classroom. The child, my language is not really important in school, just English. And a teacher, we have a super diverse cohort of children. Literacy and learning improvement in this area is a challenge. So this idea of always framing things as less than or challenging. Over to you. Oh, it's me again. Okay, I've worked with the Funds of Knowledge in Australia and Chile. I've selected the Futura Infantiloi project for this presentation because of the enduring nature of the pedagogies and practices that were developed as part of this work. To begin, a brief outline of the project. Western Sydney University began working in Chile at the invitation of the Chilean government with a brief to develop a pedagogical project that incorporated a socio-cultural approach, could strengthen teaching and learning with young children in very disadvantaged circumstances and connect families with their children's learning. Three early childhood centres, later to become 20, became the site over 7 years of participatory action research, during which over 300 educators became involved in developing site-specific pedagogies. The Australian team, some of whom are in the audience and known to some of you, Linda Newman, Leonie Arthur, Kerry Staples, and myself, resourced the extraordinary program with a range of theoretical tools, models, and approaches, which included the Funds of Knowledge approach. Recently, 7 years after the project finished, I shared the stage with one of the original educators in the project, talking about how she continues to use her adaptations of Funds of Knowledge in her work with children and families. I've found that using the concept of Funds of Knowledge and adapting the approach to fit different contexts has been a fantastic resource in my work with teaching students and with teachers working in challenging contexts who are committed to wanting to address issues of social and educational justice. In our Futura Infantiloi project, we supported project participants to both work within and to develop dialogic methods that enable great reciprocity and exchange between educators and children's families, the educators and the children, and between educators. Working with this frame now for more than 10 years in both Chile and Australia, I've seen that the concept resonates with teachers and enables them to feel more empowered with their work with both children and families. Our work in Chile particularly has shown us that when the learning and teaching is connected to children's life worlds, there can be a dramatic improvement of children's engagement in schooling and can mobilise children to share their knowledge and interests and through that deepen their learning. We also have evidence of dramatic improvements in children's learning when a Funds of Knowledge approach is combined with inquiry or project-based learning. These attempts to connect with children and families' life worlds took many forms. They included cameras, books, and artifacts that traveled to children's home, where adventures were documented and returned for sharing in the early childhood community. Countless variations of trees, where families were encouraged to share aspects of their families' lives and traditions, or their aspirations, their dreams for their children's futures, the commitments that they wanted to make for their children. These latter were very revelatory for many educators, and the following quote indicates some of the shifts. Now we have a different relationship with the family in the sense, before we used to say, can't bring this, can't do that, can't fix that, can't do painting like that, things like that. Now, actually, we interact and relate to the family in a more authentic way. Their supervisor commented, well, they're talking about the Funds of Knowledge and how they are incorporating the knowledge that the families have to work with them. Before, they used to impose what children should or could learn, and now they are taking the children's interests and family background to the learning. Very powerful data. One of the most successful ideas devised by teachers in Chile was the Literacy Cafe, where parents were invited to a small cafe sessions with the teacher. Here, dialogues took place about family life, community celebrations, and challenges parents were experiencing.
5 minutes.
Is that it? How many?
Five-minute call.
Oh, I've only got three.
No, we've got five from now.
These cafes gave teachers important insights into the lives of the children they teach and helped build a stronger bond between the teachers and parents. One of the important observations I think I can make about the use of Funds of Knowledge is how it changes relationships. Democratisation of knowledge occurs when community and family knowledge is recognised as legitimate and even important resources for school learning and provides a foundation for building relationships that's more reciprocal than authoritarian and allows the possibility for rearrangements in relations of power between home and school. As teachers' roles are repositioned from expert to researcher, deficit discourses are challenged and disrupted. We have seen this.
That's me. Okay. I'm just going to very briefly touch on three methods that came from a Department of Education funded project that set about exploring the linguistic funds of knowledge of young people in classrooms, super diverse classrooms. And by super diversity, we're talking about classrooms where between 9 and 17 languages were spoken. In this project, students were engaged and teachers, community members were engaged as researchers of themselves, of the ways they were reading, writing, talking, listening, and viewing. And the images I have up here come from kindergarten, year one and year two. Students collected pictures, catalogued images, made wordles to explore the languages that were spoken in the classroom. The methodology that came from this was also mapping, where students visually represented their linguistic lives. And you can see here two maps. The red box on the right is school, and the other side in the left-hand corner is the exciting world of home. And you can see that incredible divide. These were shared with parents. Students used them to audio record their voices, and this was done with the support of bilingual others, community aides, parents, and community where possible. One of the other things that we did was to do a bilingual reading program where simultaneous reading occurred in home language as in English, and students engaged in a whole range of audio recording. Stories were recorded in multiple languages, and they used this to explore what was happening with languages at home, and teachers use this to develop pedagogies, to create relationships and enrich their teaching and learning. Jamie?
Thanks. Can you hear me? Yeah. All right, so I'm going to share with you methods that emerged from a pilot project that I was working on with my colleagues, Professors Irben Arigny, Rob Haddam, and Dr. Ann Morrison. Now, there were two key questions that many of the participants continued to ponder throughout this project. And this project was much like the one that Chris Woodrow was talking about. And that one of them being, whose culture is operating at this time? So for instance, one site who began to question the books that they were choosing, one of the teachers said, "We felt kind of uneasy about the books we chose. The children weren't connecting to the words and concepts. Mr. McGee lives under a tree, he drinks cup of tea, even the landscape and the word steeple was very English." Such questions are important catalysts for engaging with children's funds of knowledge. Without them, we often can get stuck, taken for granted practices, such as how we communicate with families. So at the beginning of the project, many of the educators said, "Well, we do family engagement well." But as the project progressed, many of them began to realize that connections with families needed to go beyond surveys and parent-teacher interviews. They found that engaging families in dialogue through everyday moments became a really powerful source of gaining knowledge from families. Pedagogical documentation was key to this. Many of the sites wrote learning stories, and these were shared with families. Not only was this useful in making their connections to children's funds of knowledge visible, but it was also a tool for continuing to critically reflect. It also provided a space for families to share their perspectives. At the end of their learning stories, they asked parents, "What do you think about this learning, or how does this connect to your life worlds at home?" Finally, it isn't enough just to gather information about children's life worlds. As educators, we have an ethical responsibility to authentically engage as learners ourselves of that knowledge. This requires teachers to not plan too far in advance, but to engage children and families into thinking and doing in the planning process. The photo of the children on the screen, of the three children hanging over the playground equipment, this was a great example of this. The educators said typically they would have chosen the names of animals from the book as the focus words, but by being open to listening to children and families, they found there were strong connections to movement and action words.
This is our time.
Okay. This led to an increased engagement of children in creating contextualized versions of the book Summer Rain. And as we've run out of time, these are just some of our key findings across all three projects. And I'll just highlight these and we'll take time from our break. But the top one is engaging with funds of knowledge required educators to have that open mindset about children and families and what they bring. Seeing children's funds of knowledge from a strength-based approach help educators to see them as competent and resulted in increased expectations of learners. And connecting with children's home languages help to improve language and learning outcomes.
Thank you so much, Jamie and Jackie. And I'm sorry, I was so well organized and then suddenly I go to pieces. You'd think
it's all good, Chris.
It's a great pleasure to reconnect with Jenny from over many years, and she's presenting with Louise. So thank you for your presentation, Learning with Indigenous Wisdom in Times of Medical Crisis.
Unmute, Louise.
Gurumba Bidi, greetings in Yugurbal languages. I meet with you from Yagara country, and Jenny meets with you.
Oh, kia ora tātou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. Ka mihi a hau mai te whenua o te upoko o tika, te panganui a tara. He mihi aroha tēnei ki a koutou, kua tai mai nei, te pō nei, ki te whiriwhiri kōrero o pāniki tēnei kaupapa. Ki ngā mana whenua o ia rohe, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. So I just mentioned that I'm here in Wellington, what is known as the head of the fish of Maui, one of the demigods who fished up this land. And I just wanted to acknowledge the Indigenous peoples of all lands for the knowledges that they hold.
So we acknowledge Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander, our Maori, and all Indigenous people who are present with us today, and appreciate with gratitude the wisdom you have gifted planet Earth. Planet Earth and all of its living entities are in crisis born of human activity. Notably present are the dual anthropogenic crises of climate change and COVID-19. Those who are most severely impacted by climate change and COVID-19 are children and Indigenous peoples. According to UNICEF, due to the impact of the pandemic, an additional 7.5% of the world's children are living in multidimensional poverty without access to essential services. The pandemic has severely impacted on children's well-being. They have endured increased family violence and substance abuse and faced critical losses in education, with UNICEF reporting in September 2021 that children around the world have lost an estimated 1.8 trillion hours in education and counting. Indigenous peoples account for approximately 6.2% of the global population, yet are nearly three times as likely to be living in extreme poverty with significantly higher rates of infectious diseases. Indigenous populations are increasingly vulnerable to the decline of the planet's natural resources, as their way of life is so intimately connected to waters, lands, and forests, as noted in the Lancet recently. Another Lancet report highlighted that children are the most vulnerable to lifelong environmental effects caused by climate change. Indigenous peoples and children and young people deeply and bodily know the planet is in crisis, as we have seen with the global student strike for climate action movement and the numerous Indigenous peoples movements such as SEED in Australia, Pacific Climate Warriors, Te Ara Whātū, and in each of these groups, there are strong leaders, and they are asking, such as the National Director of SEED, Aboriginal South Sea Islander woman from Bundjalung country, Amelia Telford, said the other week, if you don't have what it takes to be a leader in this country, then step back and let us step up and lead. And we have witnessed underwhelming leadership with the promises that both Australia and New Zealand took to COP26, Australia being listed as the least proactive in the 60 countries. Whilst Indigenous peoples and children continue to speak out for real productive action. The images on this slide are drawings by children in response to the pandemic.
So recent research has shown that many children and young adults are experiencing a sense of existential dread related to their concerns about the climate crisis and likely compounded by now with the COVID-19 pandemic. In the New Zealand Youth 2019 survey, young people identified bleak futures and climate change as two of the four main issues that they were concerned about. That survey highlights the compounding impacts of a complex interplay of contextual determinants, which include sociocultural, socioeconomic, and historical factors, as well as personal behavioral aspects such as one's capacity for emotional regulation, the foundational dispositions of which we know are established in early childhood. For Indigenous young people, these determinants are likely to be exacerbated by the impacts of intergenerational trauma, as well as cultural and socioeconomic dislocation due to the histories of colonization. Ecological grief has been defined as a response to experienced or anticipated ecological losses, including the loss of species, ecosystems, and meaningful landscapes due to acute or chronic environmental change. Indigenous people may feel particularly intense ecological grief due to their sense of kinship with their ancestral lands and flora and fauna.
Children and Indigenous peoples are the most disenfranchised peoples globally. And as noted in the opening, they are the most affected by the convergent crises. Further, children and Indigenous peoples are the wisest people we know. Aboriginal Australians are the longest living continuous culture who lived sustainably since time began on this land that we now call Australia. Now that is worth listening to. Maori and Torres Strait Islander people also live sustainably on surrounding archipelagos for hundreds of years. Jenny and I are both of Anglo-European heritage, whose family settled or was sent to Aotearoa in Australia. We have both worked, walked, researched, and written with Aboriginal Australian and Maori sisters and brothers. We cannot speak from an Indigenous position. We draw from our work with children and Aboriginal Maori communities. We pose the provocation to listen to children and Indigenous peoples, not to just listen, but to really hear and prioritise what their embodied and emplaced wisdoms call for. We are not proposing to do good, to save or protect children and Indigenous peoples. Rather, we are tending to global crises, which the world stage is dominated by deafening white fella noise, and asking that we listen to the young and old people they know.
So we've come to understand from Aboriginal, Australian and Māori worldviews this deep relationality that is deeply felt with all living entities. And te ao Māori, the Māori worldview, the wider kinship collective extends from the originary parents, Papa Tuanaku, the earth mother, and Rangi Nui, the sky father, including human and more than human kin. So we're all related. For Māori, as with other Indigenous peoples, well-being is sourced via maintaining spiritual interconnection with ancestors, lands, rivers, mountains, oceans, forests, and creatures. Indigenous relationalities support an ethos of living with all living beings sustainably. Only take what you need, as Ngugi elder Uncle Bob Anderson shared in 1998. All living things, be they mammals, birds, reptiles, insects, or trees, are our sisters and brothers, and therefore we must protect them. We are their custodians. We not only share with them, we also guard them, which is the concept of kaitiakitanga in te ao Māori, in the Māori worldview. Furthermore, from an Indigenous worldview, it's the body's knowing or perceiving that informs other levels of consciousness. This form of multisensorial embodied knowing is not a strong feature of Western pedagogies, which are predominantly cognitivist in orientation. Drawing from these understandings, we take the view that Western educational models that privilege risk-averse cognitivist approaches are insufficient in addressing either young people's anxieties about climate change, nor in generating the sense of collectivist empowerment or skills for activist engagement, which include the capacity to take risks and challenging and reaching beyond conventional boundaries.
Because of deep ontological relationality to all living entities comes responsibility. As colleague literature woman Karen Moroney, co-author and researcher, explains about a young four-year-old from the research project. Ezra shows respect for insects as living beings and displays responsibilities for living beings that inhabit here, from catching bees that are swarming a flowering tree on the fence line, to chasing and catching small moths in his hands that have just hatched in the grass from overnight rains, and now to catch and release a stick insect. During his experiences, Ezra displays interest in the details of these beings.
5 minute call.
Makes close observations and is then happy for them to be on their way. He is connecting and caring for country, knowing the beings on the country we walk. He showed a real sense of responsibility and empowerment in the knowing and doing. Te ao Māori conceptualizations such as kai tikatanga enable young children to feel a sense of interconnectedness and of mutual responsibility for the well-being of one another and the environment. We foreground Aboriginal, Australian and Maori deep relationality with all entities and collective responsibility, not as an act of essentialization or romanticization of these worldviews. We know that colonization has severely impacted Indigenous peoples and their capacity to sustain cultural knowledges has been cut. And the children and educators and elders with whom we've had the privilege of spending time, we see the resilience of Indigenous values, which offer a powerful alternative modality to exploitative hierarchical Western paradigms. Climate action requires awareness of our interrelatedness to all others. As feminist theorist Karen Varad notes, that living compassionately requires recognizing and facing our responsibility to the infinitude of the other, welcoming the stranger whose very existence is the possibility of touching and being touched, who gifts us with both the ability to respond and the longing for justice to come. The planetary crisis requires us to face responsibility to all living entities, and Indigenous ontologies nurture such.
In Indigenous worldviews, the predominant unit of being is a collective, and children are valued for their contributions to the community, which generate shared pride. The Māori construct of mana is defined as a supernatural force manifesting prestige, authority, status, spiritual power, and charisma. Children are recognized as being born with intrinsic mana, which links them to the spiritual realm, to their ancestors, to living people, to places, and to other entities in their environment. Many Aboriginal elders, educators, and parents see it as their responsibility to teach children that they are active citizens with rights. As a teacher, Bina, in our study explained, it's important to raise children to have that confidence to be heard. We teach them about who they are and their real name, and that they are part of a family and a community who want them. Knowing your identity and that you have a community in which you belong are foundations for pride and strength. At Katoa Kindergarten in Porirua, the teachers had a strong focus on fostering children's rangatiratanga, their sense of acting as leaders, along with other core Māori values that they also fostered, such as kaitiakitanga.
In Indigenous communities, we see that children are trusted to explore and take on family and community responsibilities from early childhood. In contrast to the Western trend of risk control, bubble wrap, and chaperone childhoods, I've witnessed Aboriginal children of primary school age take their younger cousins to childcare. And Aboriginal educators provide children with time, space, and freedom to explore place in ways that they prefer. Children have independence and freedom to explore and experiment, while educators discreetly monitor their play at a distance. The educator's presence provides reassurance to children for their explorations, and when appropriate, are told of cautions and responsibilities of living with country in accordance with Aboriginal law. Jenny has observed numerous instances whereby the teachers stood alongside children without intervening, and sometimes even encouraging them what might be termed as unsafe, risky play, such as jumping from and across large outdoor equipment or boulders, as you see in the image. On one occasion, a group of boys were using the metal spades as axes, taking turns at strongly chopping at a tree root that they were determined to sever. The children seemed to read the movements of one another in an embodied collective manner whilst communicating and negotiating their movements safely, and no teacher intervention was offered or sought.
So we're advocating for the importance of listening to local Indigenous onto epistemologies to inform educational programs and to inform local governance. We're not proposing cultural appropriation, but for Western educators to work as allies in support of Indigenous aspirations. We see the need for Western decision makers, including educators and researchers, to listen to Indigenous wisdoms of intergenerational relationality, trusting children, and collective responsibility as offering hope for more moving forward. Whilst post-humanist and new materialist discourses have provided significant challenges to anthropocentric humanism, it's our contention that ignoring Indigenous onto epistemologies serves as an ongoing colonialist invisibilization of interrelationality paradigms that not only served Indigenous peoples well for many centuries prior to the impacts of colonization, but can also provide hope for the future. If only those who hold the power and decision-making roles would listen to Indigenous peoples and children and accept their own vulnerability instead of perpetuating discourses of Indigenous peoples and children's vulnerability in order to justify power over them.
That's time, 15 minutes.
And we're actually finished, but we just wanted to end by pointing out the work that we've been drawing from. On the left is our book and on the right is the paper that we just recently published. And just to acknowledge the children and the families and the communities and the teachers in particular who co-wrote the book with us and provided us with so much insight. So that's us. Kia ora tātou.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Louise and Jenny, for your provocation for deep listening and deep relationality. That was very powerful. We now have a 2-minute break. So if everyone wants to go get a cup of coffee and come back, and then we'll get started again. And Louise, I'll just need you to stop sharing the screen. Thank you. Thanks for coming back. We've got some new people on. Hi and welcome.
Okay. It's my very great pleasure. Are we ready to start, Jamie? Yes?
Yes.
It is my very great pleasure to introduce the next speakers. This presentation, Defying Deficit Children as Capable Citizens of the Now, by Dr. Jean Marie Iorio, Professor Nicola Yellen, and Dr. Jason Cooper from the University of Melbourne. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Jacqueline. I'm Nicola Yellen, and we'd like to start with an acknowledgement of country.
Thanks, Nicola. We acknowledge the ancestors, elders, and families of the Wadawurrung peoples of the Kulin Nation, who are the traditional owners of the land we are presenting from today. We would like to extend our acknowledgements to the lands of the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung peoples, where the University of Melbourne is located. As we share our own knowledges and practices here today, may we pay respects to the deep knowledge embedded within Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities across Australia, and that ownership of country has never ceded sovereignty. We present today as three non-Indigenous educators and pay our respects and extend our acknowledgements to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people as the traditional owners of Australia and its skies, waterways, climates, and land countries. Thank you.
Jamie, I'm sorry, could you move this slide? That was our slide for the
Sorry, I should have said slide.
Sorry. So we're going to talk about an industry report that Nicola and I wrote called Defying Deficit, Children as Capable Citizens of the Now. And the context and imperatives for this industry report, they came out of the 2020 COVID-19 pandemic, where we had to rethink what we regard as being normal in early childhood education and schooling. And what we really thought was that now we have opportunities from what we've learned in our pandemic experiences to fundamentally reconceptualize early childhood education and, in fact, schooling more broadly. Will the new normal take us back to our old ways of thinking or offer possibilities to create new opportunities that build on the potential of all Australian children? And we were really thinking about the questions of this symposium, which was quite lovely that they aligned so well. Specifically, what pedagogies and practices honor an image of all children as capable citizens who are valued for their contributions to their communities? And what does it mean when we move beyond cultural competence towards critical cultural integrity in early childhood pedagogy?
Because what we have noticed is that most research informing early childhood policy and practice is built on the view of young children as being in deficit of benchmark targets based on traditional views of development.
Hold on, we got to switch the slide, Nicola.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead, now go.
Okay. Oh, that's a cool, yeah. So, yeah. So based on a traditional views of development, forgetting that there are multiple childhoods and not just a universal childhood. An over-reliance on human development and human capital, on child development, I should say, and human capital theory has generated a narrow view of how early childhood research is constructed and implemented, how this research is used to make policy, and consequently does not value the contribution of children. Now, current research seeks to scalability by using intervention models in which dosage is applied to lead to a desired outcome. This limits the potential of a more inclusive and wide-ranging approach to the education of young children that recognizes the strengths that all children bring to their educational settings. Early childhood research and policy in Australia focuses on children from birth to five generally, yet the international and widely accepted definition of early childhood that education spans the years from birth to eight, and of course in Australia that spans two sectors. With a birth to five perspective, education and care are thus separated from early childhood research policy and practices so that there is no continuity in policy or practices, and this disrupts the foundational learning, early learning skills.
Next slide, please. So we really think that an alternative perspective is needed. And central to alternative narratives is an understanding that the current dominant narratives are just stories. And this is something that Peter Moss reminds us of, that in this sense, stories of child development, human capital, and cost benefit are really just stories that have been repeated over and over and over again. And they've become the truisms in research, policy, and practice. Often with this constant repetition of these stories, there's little to no recognition that other stories can coexist and no consideration of the benefits that might accrue from the alternative stories or narratives. Further, by incorporating alternative narratives, the question of why emerges. In this case, the questions raised are around child development, human capital, cost benefit, and the overriding question of why are children seen as incapable and in deficit. And so the alternative perspective that we propose is on children's learning in order to rethink early childhood research, policy, and practice that values the contribution of all children. And in the next slide, Nicola will describe what this alternative perspective could be.
So the next slide, please. We believe that viewing children as capable contributing citizens enables an approach to research, policy, and practices that respond to contemporary issues and is relevant to the lives of all Australian children. Rinaldi offers an image of the child as citizen of the child as a citizen of the now, activating an alternative narrative of the child as capable and contributing. She says, the child is not a citizen of the future. He or she is a citizen from the very first moment of life and also the most important citizen because he represents and brings the possible, a statement for me that is without rhetoric. And of course, Moss, Dahlberg, and Pence bring this image further by seeing children as producers, meaning that children determine the institutes we provide for the pedagogical work that adults and children undertake in the institutions that we work in. This movement recognizes many childhoods and children not waiting upon scientific knowledge to tell us who the child is. Rather, choices are made about who we think the child is, and these choices have enormous significance. drawing on these ideas and engaging directly with the question of what is the image of the child, we are relocating the child as a citizen of the now, capable and contributing to the world from birth. This provokes a further question: what is our image of the child in research? Consideration of this question within our chosen image of the child provides the opportunity to rethink how and why we do research in early childhood. We are making a political choice to use the image of the child, creating spaces for alternative narratives to inform how we construct research in early childhood education. Research generated through the collaborative relationships between universities and industries and between teachers and researchers offers a conceptual and pedagogical evidence base needed to inform the technical, the structures, the policies that defined early childhood understandings and practices. There is already research happening these ways, and in this way, and in our industry report, we provide case studies, which we would like to brief, some of which we'd like to briefly outline for you now.
So the first case study is called Out and About, and this is an example of the university and industry as research collaborators. Just to let you know that I lead Out and About with Catherine Hamm, who's the next person discussing, so there'll be some overlap in between these. So Out and About is a qualitative research project done with Dr. Catherine Hamm and myself at the University of Melbourne in collaboration with schools and early childhood centers, and is based on the image of the child as capable contributing citizens of the now, drawing again on Rinaldi's ideas. At the heart of the Out and About project is environmental justice, the practice of nurturing and inventing enduring multi-species human and non-human kindreds, which comes from Donna Haraway. The current devastating state of the environment indicates how humans are no longer in relation with non-humans, evident in the decisions that further human convenience over non-human existence. Out and About generates pedagogies to support children and teachers in building relationships with their local environments and the multi-species that live there. Out and About is connected to the Common Worlds Research Collective, which is a network of international interdisciplinary scholars concerned with relations with the more than human worlds. Specifically, Out and About focuses on the contact zone, which comes also from Donna Haraway, and place noticing, which is specific to Catherine Hamm, and she'll be speaking a little bit about this today, where children and teachers and researchers all recognize local places as agentic and active in building relations between human and the more than human. In practice, Out and About always begins with acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land and intentionally foregrounds Indigenous worldviews as part of everyday teaching and learning. Critical to this work is the view of children as capable of contributing towards environmental change. The Out and About project uses a learning with place framework, which is something that's been written by Catherine and I, and specifically begins with foregrounding Indigenous worldviews that underpin the framework, and recognize how learning and teaching is always in relation with human, more than human, and local place. Part of this is the practice of coming alongside, which comes from Karen Martin, and offers a way for non-Indigenous people to respectfully work with Indigenous worldviews. Coming alongside calls for time. Time in this sense is time to listen with local elders, place, and the more than human. And this comes from Sue Atkinson. In Out and About, coming alongside is practiced as teachers, children, and researchers pay attention to what calls them into connection as they walk and listen with local place, practicing slow pedagogy. And we're talking about slow pedagogy. This really comes from the slow food movement from the 1980s, and this idea that the slowness opens up the space for relations to happen through listening, pondering, and paying attention to the historical, ethical, cultural, and political within a place. Richness and articulation of complex ideas occur through these slow pedagogies.
Five minutes.
So Jason is going to share some of the work he's done with Catherine and I. So it's going to be a little musical part now. Go ahead, Jason.
That's right. Thanks, Jean. So I joined the Out and About program with Catherine a few years ago now, pre-COVID, and it's at an inner city kindergarten in Melbourne on Wurundjeri country. And the children were mapping seasons, the cooling seasons over a year. And I came and visited with my guitar as a musician, and we walked the creek that's right beside the kindergarten, and we spent a lot of time with that creek. Over a period of months, children would tell me different stories about the creek. They pointed out teapot tree, where it's a tree that looks like a teapot. They took me to a tree, a eucalyptus tree, and they called the returning tree, where wherever they took something from country, from place, they returned it back to place. And that follows Arnie Joy Wanda Murphy's book, Welcome to Country, which is one of the key texts that they were using, and they took it inside and outside of the kindergarten. As we sat by the creek, children would tell me stories. They'd tell me about two sacred birds for the Wurundjeri people, Bunjil, the creator, and Bunjil's friend, Wah, the protector of the waterways. They told me about the stepping stones, where they stepped across the stones on the creek. They told me how you step on the stones. They told me about Yabby and how they've seen Yabby in the creek. They told me about Heron, who sits in the tree watching Yabby. And as we're sitting and walking country and walking place with the guitar, some chords emerged. So we sort of had a musical base to write some lyrics to. So together we sat underneath the trees, and the children said the experiences that they've had along the creek, and we constructed it together into this song called Reflections by the Water.
Bunjil is flying over, the warriors watching closely. Children are sitting on the ground, they are making music, they are making music. They are making. Yabby is blowing bubbles, and Heron is watching closely. Children are stepping with stone, reflections in the water, reflections in the water. They shimmer, 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 shimmer. Reflections in the water, they shimmer, 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 shimmer.
And then from that, that was another way of our children to not only make their learning visible but also audible. And that then leaves me on a note about multimodality, to embrace different modes of communication and expression of our relations with and to Indigenous territories, lands and waters. Next slide.
Yeah, next. Thanks, Jason. And as another example of a sort of partnership between universities and schools and indeed education systems, we did a project in South Australia when I was at Flinders University called the STEM Bridge Project. And that was based in six different sites across South Australia, both rural as far as Port Lincoln and down to Mount Gambier, and in the city, Parafield Gardens. And it was about STEM learning ecologies, but it was also about the transition process and moving beyond that, the notion of transition as orientation. And it was, you know, the aims were related to creating a vision for young children as one in which they would be confident learners who were articulate, respectful, and knowledgeable. And as part of that, there was the sharing of pedagogies between the preschool and the reception teachers. And it was very much as Jason and Jean and Catherine have done, going out and about. And one of the schools had an area next to the kindergarten and school that was called the Wirra. And they were able to have these Wirra wanderings. So they were able to go out into an environment that was outside the school, but not too far away, where the preschoolers could come together with the reception five-year-olds, and they could wonder about the things around them. And there was a lot of time spent noticing. And again, as Jason said, when these were talked about back when they were having conversations, they represented their ideas and they made meanings in multimodal formats. But one of the things in terms of the teachers' pedagogies that was important was this idea, okay, I'm coming to the end now, Jacqueline, was this idea of having these pedagogical conversations and focusing on taking that time and that slow pedagogy that Jean's mentioned already. And I think this is very important, and changing the form of questions, simple things like the teachers saying to the children, rather than what do you know about words, birds, what are your ideas about birds, and the conversations that came around that very much in it from a different perspective. So I'll leave it there because you'll be able to read these case studies in the report, and thank you for your time. Thank you, Jacqueline.
So it is my pleasure to introduce the next presentation, Place Noticing, Creating the Conditions for Ethical and Political Pedagogies, from Catherine Hamm, Melbourne Graduate School of Education, the University of Melbourne. Thank you, Catherine.
Thanks, Jacqueline. Hi, everybody. I begin with acknowledging the ancestors, elders and families of the Wadawurrung people, who are the traditional custodians of the land where I'm presenting from today. I also acknowledge the ancestors, elders and families of the Wurundjeri, Boonwurrung and Bunurong peoples where this research took place. I pay my respects to the deep knowledges embedded within Aboriginal communities and the ongoing connection of and care for country. I also acknowledge the connections with creek and park, provoke learning with wattle, lorikeet, heron and yabby, and many others as we learn with and care for sky country, the waterways and the land. I acknowledge that the land continues to be a place of learning where it has been for many thousands of years. Next slide, please. So I'm going to be sharing just a few ideas around place noticing and how that might create the conditions for ethical and political pedagogies. Next slide, please. I'm a sixth generation settler to Bunurong and Boonwurrung country. My ancestors were uninvited from Cornwall and London. I was born on Wurundjeri country and Lutruwita, now known as Tasmania, Bunurong and Boonwurrung country grew me up as I spent my childhood moving back and forth across Bass Strait, visiting family on Bunurong and Boonwurrung country every fish trap season. Next slide, please. The COVID-19 global pandemic has generated many conversations about the benefits of engaging with the outdoor environment as an antidote to the public health orders that have required people to stay at home to prevent the spread of contagion. Conversations have focused on the benefits of being able to get outdoors to combat mental health issues brought on by the pandemic. As children return to face-to-face learning at school, outdoor classrooms are being featured as a way for children to catch up on their learning in a safe space where the spread of the virus might be limited. This focus on the environment rarely attends to the fact that all outdoor activity in Australia and other colonised countries takes place on unceded First Nations land. Instead, a romanticised story of what the environment can provide for a pandemic-stricken human world is offered. First Nations histories and stories of place are not often included in these conversations. Creating the conditions for ethical and political pedagogies requires attending to place in different ways, beyond the script of saving humans. Central to creating these conditions is what Fikile Numalo names as refiguring. Refiguring works to trouble settler logics by intentionally foregrounding First Nations worldviews as part of everyday teaching and learning. What does it mean to refigure First Nations histories, stories, ways of knowing in my everyday? I wonder how place can be noticed in different ways beyond the script of saving humans. What does it mean to activate my ethical and political settler accountabilities in non-extractive ways? These questions provoke experimental practices that activate learning with local places beyond a romanticized antidote to a pandemic world. I notice golden wattle blooming. She is showering everything around in fine golden wattle dust. It is July and cold west wind season. The cold is swirling around my body. This is the second encounter I've had with wattle blooming this week, and I wonder what is happening here on Bunurong and Boonwurrung country. I've walked with this country over long periods of time, attending to the cues from sky country, waterways, and the land that signify shifting seasons. I've not noticed wattle blooming in cold west wind season before. I wonder why wattle is blooming now. What does it mean for wattle? Next slide, please. Activating ethical and political accountabilities as a settler requires making choices. intentions that engage with complexity and do not shy away from ongoing colonial inheritances or only engaging with First Nations knowledges when it's convenient. This requires me to sit with uncomfortable knowledges and histories, to acknowledge that ongoing colonial legacies are always part of being with the world. Activating my ethical and political accountabilities requires slowness and to come alongside, a practice that Karen Martin describes as a way for non-First Nations people to respectfully engage with First Nations worldviews. Over many years, I have learned that coming alongside requires waiting to be invited, to sit and listen, slowness, and an understanding that First Nations worldviews are not always available to non-First Nations people. Coming alongside requires authentic relationships and a genuine commitment to respectfully foregrounding First Nations perspectives in everyday teaching and learning. As a way to come alongside, I've been working with the experimental practice of place noticing. So place noticing is underpinned by the concepts of coming alongside and place as a pedagogical contact zone, which Jean spoke about a bit earlier. But just to remind you, place as a pedagogical contact zone is understood as places are always in a state of entanglement of human and more than human others. And the term contact zone from Donna Haraway gestures towards the ways in which entanglements occur and how we can learn with and from place. Place noticing requires looking beyond taken for granted colonial approaches to being in the outdoors or playing in nature. Taking inspiration from Vanessa Watts, an Anishinaabe woman from Canada, place noticing understands place and, as I quote, being alive and thinking, end quote. Active and agentic, not reliant on human intervention or savior approaches. Place noticing is speculative, and attends to who and what calls us into connection in unpredictable ways. In Australia, all places are entangled in ongoing colonial inheritances that are often overlooked. Place noticing generates practices that are speculative, imperfect, impartial, and unpredictable. There are no set outcomes or goals to achieve. Place noticing practices are slow, quiet, and resist the human temptation to name and know everything that is seen, smelled, or heard. Place noticing is sensorial, affective, and generates relational connections that are not explained as sensory input. These connections can be ethereal, leaving traces in ways that can't always be articulated. Place noticing practices begin with attending with the world, being called into connection, and include walking with, coming to know local places over time, not as a destination, but as kin. Place noticing practices generate openness, relationality, and provoke connections with other than human lives, activating what Donna Haraway calls environmental justice. Place noticing practices require intentionally shifting aside human exceptionalism, disrupting the desire to know and explain the world. Place noticing practices are experimental, open to different ways of documenting noticings beyond a scientific view. Place noticing practices are interdisciplinary and bring together a range of perspectives to make meaning with the world through arts, music, and story. And you've just heard some beautiful place music. Next slide, please. So in the next section, I'm going to share a little bit about a project that I did with some examples of place noticing. So the project was a pedagogical inquiry from the Out and About project called Out and About with Cool and Seasons. But before I share some of the details, it's important to activate cultural protocols and respectful ways. As a settler to the unceded lands that this pedagogical inquiry is generated with, I acknowledge the generous sharing of First Nations teachings and environmental knowledges that are an integral part of the Out and About with Cool and Seasons project. I acknowledge ongoing relationships with and teachings from Auntie Dr. Sue Atkinson, Annette Sachs, and Janae Serra. I also acknowledge important teachings from the work of Auntie Joy Murphy and Lisa Kennedy and Uncle Bill Nicholson. The Out and About with Cool and Seasons is a collaborative inquiry generated with preschool teachers, their children, and local Aboriginal artists and educators. We spent long periods of time attending to the entangled relations of children, places, multi-species communities. Inspired by the work of Uncle Bill Nicholson, a Wurundjeri elder, our inquiry activated pedagogical intentions that foreground understandings of the seasonal shifts in our local places beyond the linear inverted Northern Hemisphere framework of summer, autumn, winter, and spring. First Nations seasonal knowledges generate deep understandings of the entangled relation of plants, animals, waterways, skies, as weather patterns shift and move. These knowledges are always already in our local places, but are often overpowered, hidden by colonial legacies. Our inquiry troubled these colonial narratives of seasonal shifts by refiguring and intentionally foregrounding First Nation, the nation's seasonal knowledges. So on the screen is our noticing from the whole year. So creek is, I guess, the central focus, but you might like to see heron eating yabby, and you can see wah and bunjil. And so we engaged with those seasons through the year. So we were provoked in our inquiry by the powerful words of Wurundjeri elder Auntie Joy Murphy that are shared in the picture storybook Welcome to Country. And as part of that book, there is the invitation to take a leaf from the branches of the white river gum. If you accept a leaf, and we hope that you do, it means that you are welcome to everything from the tops of the trees to the roots of the earth, but you must only take from this land what you can give back. The powerful imperative to only take what you can give back provokes much of our learning. So I'd just like to share a place narrative, attending to sky country. I walk quietly with a small group of preschool children. Sorry, next slide, please. I walk quietly with a small group of preschool children into the stand of she-oak trees that are entangled with multiple types of wattle blooming on this cold west wind season day. It's a favourite place for us to come when we visit park. We lie on our backs under tall, drooping tree canopies, catching tiny glimpses of the vivid blue sky country. We lie without talking or moving, entangled with wind, sun, she-oak needles, lorikeet and barwang. In the stillness, I attune to the traces that she-oak needles are leaving on my skin and the breeze that moves my hair. I watch as wattle blossoms fall gently to the ground. After a few minutes of stillness, we slowly stand up and wonder what we might learn from wattle. Remember when we noticed wattle sap running down wattle's trunk? This question provokes memories of walking with wattle season. Wattle is prolific in park, growing in stands of 5 or 6 different varieties. We've come to notice different sizes and shapes of wattle blossom over time. Our entanglement with wattle's blossoms provokes closer noticing, and children begin to document their encounters. Next slide, please. Our encounters with wattle respond to pedagogical intentions that focus on only taking what you can give back. Small amounts of wattle sap, bark and wattle blossoms are collected, documented, curated and returned to park. So that was the returning tree that Jason spoke about. We returned them to the base of the returning tree. These practices generate deep connections that foster different kinds of relations with the environment. Deep connections to our local places are anchored in sustained relations over time, where there are authentic opportunities to learn with places. We've spent long periods of time documenting the changes to plants, animals, waterways, weather patterns, star systems over time. Next slide, please. Place noticing generates pedagogies from the storied everyday moments of messy, complicated encounters with place, human, and more than human others. There is a deliberate intention to disrupt Euro-Western conceptions of innocent children playing in nature and to respectfully foreground and refigure First Nations perspectives, enact environmental justice and accountabilities in everyday teaching and learning. These intentions have the possibility to generate practices that shift Western worldviews and embrace more inclusive ways of seeing and being in the world. Ones that acknowledge the interconnected relationships with more than human others that underpin life on Earth and the importance of learning with, not just about, our world. For early childhood educators, this means doing and thinking differently in order to cultivate a hopeful climate future where we do and think differently with our planet. Thank you.
Thank you. 45 seconds to spare, Catherine.
Well done. Thank you, Catherine. That was very inspiring. I have the privilege of introducing the discussion panel now. The job of the discussion panel is to sort of provoke thought, discussion, to make comment on the presentations that we've listened to so far. So first I will introduce Professor Pauline Harris. Pauline Harris is a professor at the University of South Australia, and she's a member of CREZI. Next, I'll introduce Lynn Rutherford. She is a chief executive officer at Gowrie SA. And last but not least, I'd like to introduce you to Emma Durdren. She's a teacher and also interim director at Ingle Farm Children's Center. All right, so if the three discussion panel members want to turn their cameras on so we can see you and take your mute buttons off, we'll start with Pauline. Pauline, do you have any comments or questions for the presenters?
Oh, thank you very much, Jamie. And thank you very, very much to all the presenters for marvelous presentations. My mind is dancing very happily, having engaged with these wonderful works. You presented a rich kaleidoscope where with each presentation, we've taken a different turn at looking at issues that strike at the heart of culturally inclusive pedagogies. I'm reminded of the words of Barbara, who talked about third space some time ago, and the in-between. And in the in-between space is where we come to understand the meaning of our cultures, and where we come to know the others of ourselves. And I love that expression, the others of ourselves. And to me, that is a core idea that resonates in my mind and brings together the rich and diverse presentations that we've had the privilege of listening to today. And I'm wondering, you know, arising from these presentations, how can we cultivate the others of ourselves in coming together with shared wisdom and celebrate the wisdom that often goes unnoticed, as has been pointed out today? How can we come together collectively, authentically, connected with one another in relationships of respect and trust and kindness and compassion for the greater good, where place and voice matters, particularly the voice of children? So I suppose out of all that, my question becomes one of how do all of these really important ideas and practices that we want to see advanced through the early childhood profession and with children, how does that all fit with the neoliberal discourses that are dominating our educational times these days, reducing education to individualistic, performative, competitive approaches? As an early years literacy researcher, I experience and witness this firsthand, and that the treacherous road that sometimes educators find themselves walking from the kinds of thinking and realities we've explored today to what then they find imposed upon themselves. And when I say early childhood, I am including the early school years as well as the preschool years. So may I put to presenters that question, how we can reconcile the celebration and the necessity and value of the key messages and practices we've heard this afternoon in the prevailing context that many educators find themselves working in and are and feel their agency restricted. How can we support teachers' agency to be agents of change and to be advocates of the good work they're doing?
I think I'll turn that question to Nicola, because you were talking a bit about that policy dialogue, weren't you?
Yeah, thanks, Jamie. I'm going to direct you to our report. I mean, that was one of the imperatives that moves us to writing the report, Pauline. The University of Melbourne does these industry reports from the graduate school. And that's why we wanted to present the case studies. Mm-hmm. And we presented three in the paper, in the actual paper, to show how you could exactly do that. And provide alternative viewings and alternative ways of being that were that disrupted the neoliberal discourse. And there was one more, actually, it came out of West Australia as well, which has since been just about to be published in our journal, Global Studies of Childhood. But, you know, it's working from that perspective of young children as capable citizens of the now and showing how that, you know, in fact, it complements what the sort of so-called outputs, but it is that the traditional discourses perpetuate this sort of knowledge building in terms of outputs. It shows how everything comes together in and just like Peter and Peter Moss and Gunilla do it with in terms of quality, sort of taking the agenda and focusing on meaning making. You know, we're taking the agenda and focusing on young children as capable citizens in the now. And we're not just saying that as an abstract concept, we're actually showing you in these case studies what that looks like.
Yeah. Nicola, you could also talk about our recommendations.
Yes, which is...
So our recommendations, including supporting and funding research that views children as capable and contributing citizens, and how that looks when you do collaborations between universities, schools, early childhood and citizen and industry. Rethinking early childhood policies to define early childhood as birth through age 8 and not to be separated. Change early childhood teacher registration to be inclusive of early childhood settings from birth to age 8. Create government-funded professional learning system that supports teachers to act as researchers and do this kind of work in their classrooms.
We had 7, Paula.
My page just moved. Here we go. Implement early childhood initial teacher education courses that include a focus on teachers as researchers, teaching and learning practices that foreground Indigenous worldviews and connect with place and social issues, and seeing education as a cultural, political, and ethical endeavor. Provide funding for current teachers to learn how to respectfully foreground Indigenous worldviews and connect with local place and social issues, and then highlight and fund the establishment of early childhood programs for children birth to age 8, including governance structures and policies to empower children to be active participants in local and global communities.
That's marvelous. Thank you, Jean, and thank you, Nicola, for that really full and comprehensive response. And I asked the question, not thinking you wouldn't have responses, but to remind us that that is the context and reality we're working with. And I think as researchers, as early childhood leaders, we all need to take on board that that kind of question and how we consider that kind of a question when formulating our research, when formulating our professional learning experiences we make available for educators, when indeed engaging with policymakers to be able to realise that there are those tensions there. How can we work with those tensions? So thank you very much.
Thanks, Pauline, for that question. We're now going to go to Lynn.
Namani, everyone. Thank you so much to the presenters for your really careful and thought-provoking presentations today. It's been fabulous, and I can already feel 1,000 ideas coming from it about some work that we can do in our children's programs. We have to be able to see the incredible possibilities offered by children and younger generations. They are challenging norms, they're marching for climate change, and to be honest, they're probably asking for far more than we as adults are doing. So they will lead the way with or without us, I suspect. But we have such an opportunity to move our thinking about learning beyond concepts such as literacy and numeracy to much broader concepts which support literacy and numeracy, such as activism. And so we have this curriculum that is set up to think in quite narrow lines and boxes, which kind of builds a lot on what Pauline was saying, I believe. And activism, actually, when we think about our holistic practices, is something that can cover all. And just to give you an example, children have a really strong sense of justice and fairness. And in the children's programs, our children wrote a letter to the Federal Minister for the Environment about the felling of the birthing trees, because they felt quite strongly about this. And so they were passionate about it, and they created a letter and they sent it to the minister. And the minister did, in fact, respond. But as you can imagine, it was a fairly generic letter. But if we all as educators and leaders encourage children to be stronger activists, there might be far more interest from politicians in thinking about these bigger picture things that are impacting on children now and into the future. So I know that we use the phrase a lot that children are capable and competent, and they absolutely are, but sometimes our actions as educators can contradict this. And so I'm wondering from our panel members, you know, what your thoughts are about how we support educators to engage more deeply with the creative pedagogies that we've heard about here today, when they're often not really engaging with research.
All right, I'll turn that over to you, Chris. Oh, Chris, there you go.
Yeah. Gosh, Lynn, thanks.
That's okay. Just a light question for the end of the day.
Look, I think that's an enormous challenge, actually. You know, it's resource intensive. We're asking for resources. We're asking for generosity. But as you probably know, you know, over more than a decade, many of us have worked with those practitioner research strategies. And I mean, even in the presentation I made today, for me to be able to revisit people many years after their first contact with these methodologies, to see them practicing and amending them, they are enduring. So I think equipping our new generation educators with those kinds of skills is critical with an inquiry dimension. So I'm sure others have got things to say as well.
Yeah, and just even from my experience in the project that I was presenting on, starting with those critical questions, questioning those things that we take for granted. I can't tell you how often, you know, it was in those small moments of teachers going back to things and going, oh, actually, you're right. We hadn't really thought of that before. We did think that we had great relationships with our families. We thought that we were, you know, communicating. We thought we were connecting with country, but it's actually in that moment of that critical reflection and say, whose culture is activated at this point in time? Whose voices are being heard? Who are we listening to? I think starting with those, that having that time and space for that critical reflection is key. And Louise, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, I've been very interested in this notion of children's activism for a long time. It was very much the focus of the Spencer project that we drew from. And we went into that project really wanting to support, a class-based, centre-based, community-based projects around active citizenship in terms of, working on if it's a particular issue to create change around. But recognising, so the communities we were working with were living in crisis. Every day they were in survival mode. So to do something proactive where your teacher's really building upon and supporting wasn't able to kind of come through. And then we recognized, hang on a sec, children are actually initiating action constantly. So it's to really notice those little moments, like there was, the moment of the phone, this toy phone, getting damaged and then how to repair it. There was, the project around a bee and you're wanting to catch a bee. So it's noticing the small moments, and it's what I put in the chat there. I think we start to think quite grand, but if we notice that in the small moments and support children and recognise the agency they have in those moments that emerge spontaneously.
Thanks. I might just turn it over to Emma now.
I would actually love to continue the discussion we're having. Obviously, as a teacher, I guess a lot of what the other discussion panelists have already said is really resonating with me, in that Life is very busy when you're, you know, out in the world working, you know, on the front line with children and other educators. And in terms of like listening to the research presented, it's been really refreshing and inspiring again to be able to listen, you know, to what has been happening in the world in the last 2 years, because I feel like I've missed, you know, so much with just trying to cope, as everyone has been. I guess that's been very reaffirming to listen to what, you know, people have been doing and what the research is saying, and that we are, you know, within my sight, I guess, still heading on the right track around advocating for children and their families around the things that we believe that are critically important for them, you know, around well-being and, you know, relationship skills and things, and not always the hardline literacy or numeracy, and that there's ways of doing those things that capture the child and what's meaningful to them and important. I guess I was having a look at the chat and I was thinking to myself, where does the child with special rights fit within this? And that's been one of the biggest challenges for us within the site that I'm in that 60% of my families are English second language speaking, and accessing that the child and the family's life worlds and making you know, an educational site, an open and inviting place for those people to feel that they have a voice, and that they can actually engage with their children's education, that they have a place within their children's education, and the educators want, you know, want to know from them, and giving that message across of them being experts in their own, you know, their own child's life and their own family's life. Even conveying that message to families can be really, really difficult. And then adding again that layer of, you know, the child with special rights who may be nonverbal, you know, who may have other physical needs associated with that. And how do we go about capturing that child and that family's life worlds, and being respectful of that and, you know, drawing out that information and using it to capture their strengths. So I guess I would love to know, yeah, people's perspectives on that, and what, yeah, what you have to offer.
Sue, we haven't heard from you yet. Do you have anything to add to that?
So, Jamie, did you mean me?
You yes, sorry.
I was attending. I'd just like to thank the presenters for really thought-provoking and stimulating presentations. I think it's been an amazing session and some really interesting conversations to not only be carried along and continued, but for some people, I guess, started in ways that they might not have thought of before. And I was taken by the chat. I was looking at something in the chat then with Jamie, which is why I wasn't as responsive as I could have been, because I was thinking about the point about activism being possibly being seen as a privilege. And that for me is something that I need to give deeper thought to, having been involved in a project about activism a couple of years ago. So I was pondering on that, but I'll probably just say one thing, and that is we've seen lots of possibilities and lots of things that are actually happening, being done, being undertaken. So the taken for granted stuff is being challenged every day, and lots of the examples given in the presentations today show how that's happening. So I have very positive hopes for the future. And I think people are working really hard at thinking carefully and making it possible for other people to experience the sorts of things that have been shared today. So they're happening. Things are happening, word spreading in big and little ways, and it takes all ways. Thank you.
Very good point. Thank you, Sue. I have to say, Emma, in terms of connecting with children with special rights, I mean, I think it's almost the same. I've seen this thread coming through all the presentations today about seeing all children as being competent and capable. And I think that goes also for children with special rights. And so it's about slowing down. It's about listening. And I know that teachers and educators have a lot of a pressure to do certain things. But if we're not connecting with the child and their family and their funds of knowledge, then it's harder to meet those sort of external goals. And so we first have to make those connections with the family. And the project that we were a part of, the best way of doing it was having those everyday conversations, talking with families every day and not being afraid. But I could tell you how many times I've talked to teachers and they're terrified to speak to families. But once you get over that initial nervousness of, oh, I don't want to say something wrong, and parents can see that you are authentically really eager to hear about their life worlds, to hear about their child, you respect and you value their knowledge, then they become happy to share more. And so I think that's key, to think about the relationships we have, not just with children, but with their families as well. Does anyone else have something? Jackie?
I was just going to say that I think for teachers, it's also supporting them in seeing how real learning can happen as a result of starting with strength. Do you know that you can meet outcomes, that you can do all those things really that they're under pressure to do in terms of curriculum outcomes and so on. And I think that it creates this larger kind of action within a classroom. I mean, the work that we've been doing with young people, work with like 1,000 young people now, getting them to explore their language, it just facilitated parents coming in and more discussion and more agency for everyone, because everyone was engaged and real learning actually happened. And I think creating a situation, facilitating an opportunity for that to happen is really key. And I think it moves across all of those things, student agency, teacher agency, and bringing parents and community in and feeling like they are actually supported and they do have a real voice.
I think I might put a question back to the discussion panel. And Emma, we might start with you. How do you think your engagement with this symposium, how do you think this might inform your future work, or what are some of the key takeaways that you will take away back to your team after tonight?
Yep. So I guess I've had the privilege of obviously working with Jamie a little bit in the past around an action research project, and that really is what started all of our thinking here for myself and colleagues around funds of knowledge and how critically important it is to access every child's life world. So I guess it's, again, like I said, it's that having had 2 years of craziness since that, knowing that we're still on the right track and being reaffirmed in knowing that the research and, you know, there's so many experts that are within this cyber room right now, us have still got our backs, you know, on the ground, and that there is so much evidence to support what we know is right for children and their families. So for me, I guess, and what we are continuing to do here is really trying to work out how to connect with families and make our families feel acknowledged, supported, respected, like they're welcome within the space. And, you know, being in a very, very super diverse community that I work within, that means different things for different families. And I guess part of what I was getting at around special rights is that it's not always the verbal, it's not always the conversation. And so that's an area that we've started to look into is the use of technology. So Seesaw, Facebook, social media, engaging with families, even, you know, them just bringing in a photograph of their child or showing us something on their phone that they've done during the weekend. And it doesn't have to be, you know, a conversation. It's just that reciprocity with the family. And so I guess that's part of what we're working on. And so that Christine was, you know, showing the family trees and things, and that's something that we have sort of taken and continued to develop. Having that real sense of belonging in the space, and children and families seeing themselves represented, and this is actually a place for you, and this is, you know, how do we capture that and move it forward, I guess, in the you know, this day and age where families have been unable to come into the centre up until last week. My families, you know, have not been able to bring their children in. They haven't been able to see the ped doc that's up on the walls. So everything has had to be very digital, you know, or up on boards outside, and thinking about all of those sorts of different ways of engaging. So I guess, yeah, that's one thing that I'm continuing to work on. And I think, again, just going back to, you know, the principles of Reggio and how much they can inform what we do as educators, you know, the 100 languages, the sense that there is no one version of childhood, and every child is capable and competent in their own way, and it's about finding the strengths. And I think always coming back, I guess, to saying to my educators, like, take off the lens of what you know, of your experiences as a child, as a parent yourself, and just stop, look, listen, and watch what the children are doing and what they're trying to tell us, not just with their words, but with their actions, with the way they're engaging with each other, with the way they're not engaging with each other, you know, what they're doing with the materials that we have available and the resources. And that's part of, Jamie, you've inspired a lot of that, was that really, really deep listening and observing, and then that critical reflection of what is actually going on here for the child, for the family, and what does that mean for me as an educator? So I guess...
Claire and I are kind of having a little giggle because I know the road that they've been on, but it was something that they had a struggle that... by listening and watching carefully, they were able to work it out. So maybe we could share that work sometime, Emma.
yeah, it really, and that has been the biggest learning for us. And that's what we're constantly coming back to, is just stop, and the slowing down, and just being, observing, looking, listening, noticing what's going on for children and their families without judgment, taking your own lens off.
Lynn, we'll go to you.
So I guess probably some key takeaways from me are that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander histories and knowledges are so important, and children, unlike many adults, have no issues accepting this history. The respect and acceptance evidence in children has so much to teach us. So I think that, you know, our challenge is to slow down, to go deeper, and to sit with our discomfort. We don't like feeling uncomfortable, and white people in particular don't like feeling uncomfortable because we are used to positions of power and superiority. But children will show us the way. And we've been probably working in the reconciliation space for about 10 years, and it still feels like we're at the beginning of that journey. And we still get pushback from people who say, it was great, but why do we spend so much time on this? Why can't we look at other cultures? And I still cannot believe it every time I hear that. I think, how have we not got there yet? So there's a long way to go. And the other thing I think is that, you know, we've learned a lot about children's possibilities as activists, but I guess we also have to learn a bit more about pushing the boundaries. And when I hear that, you know, parents haven't come on site, we never stopped our parents coming on site, because we had to analyse what was best for children, and being dropped off at the car park or at the door, we felt wasn't best for children. It wasn't in children's interests. And so we never stopped our parents coming on site. Doesn't mean at some point we won't have to make that decision, but we never felt like we needed to make it over the last year and a half. And so I guess we as adults have to try and understand how we can challenge the things that keep constraining us, whether it's the national quality standards, whether it's understanding how to talk about creative pedagogies in better ways so that they are an accepted part of our programs, not just ticking the box of, yes, you do this and this is clean. So it's a massive challenge, I think, when we're faced with, you know, government policy that is really set up to constrain and constrict and be about safety. So, yes, that's my takeaway from all this, and I appreciate the stimulation to, you know, my thinking.
Thank you, Lynn. And Pauline? Oh, I think she's not there. All right, well.
Oh, sorry. I was muted and non-videoed. My apologies. I'll be quick. No, I didn't nick off earlier.
No, I was listening with great interest. I think for me it's around diversifying the notion of child as capable citizen. I mean, when we use those phrases, we talk about the child, capable citizen, you know, and we need to move away from the normalizing of using the singular to using the plural and diversifying our notions of what it means for children to be activists, such as I've seen in the chat space here, the notion of privileging of activism, but there's different ways that activism can be expressed. So it's diversifying our notions of what we mean about children as capable, as with children with wisdom, children that are going to take us forward with or without us, as Lynn so pertinently put. And I'm going to carry that forward with my research collaborations that I'm leading with Jenny Ritchie and Louise Phillips, my wonderful colleagues here, and other colleagues elsewhere around the world, in continuing to research and foster and support pedagogies of dialogue and the way that we support teachers and their professional learning in that space. So there's lots of rich and diverse messages that I've gleaned from this afternoon that will help inform that. But yeah, diversifying, when we talk about our vision of children, being sure we always talk in the plural. Thanks, Jamie.
Well, I'd like to say a thank you to the discussion panel for being here today and helping engage us in some deep thinking and dialogue. I think that having dialogue like this is really important because it helps us think through multiple perspectives about the work that we're doing and how we can expand on that. We only have a few moments left, so I will just, before we draw the symposium to a close, I do want to say some massive thank yous. And first of all, a massive thank you to the audience members who have joined us from around the world. We've had people from Japan, the US, people had to get up at 11 o'clock in some places in the middle of the night. And I think it's close to 1 a.m. now. So thank you for coming, much appreciated. I'd also like to thank Teach and Krezi and their center directors for their sponsorship of this symposium. Without your support, this would have been a very difficult process. So I thank you very much, Anna, for your work in kicking us off today and all the support. I've thanked Sarah Manitakis earlier, but I'll say her name again because she was the one behind the scenes helping with our registrations and making sure that everyone was able to connect today. I would especially like to thank Chris Woodrow for being the co-chair and also co-founder of this group, and to Jackie Duarte for being the timekeeper, which is a difficult job, and I thank you for taking it off my hands. And especially last but not least, the CIECP network, that's everyone who presented today, for their generosity of spirit and sharing their research and just being such great colleagues. This has been an amazing experience, and I'm glad that I've had a chance to engage in dialogue and learn from you all, and I look forward to carrying it forward. So if you're interested in hearing more about our group or learning about what people are doing, we plan on sharing some things on our Facebook page. We have a new Facebook page, so it's not much is on there yet, but it's Culturally Inclusive Early Childhood Pedagogies. Check us out, and we will have this session recorded, and it will be available to you all soon. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful night or a wonderful day.